Thank you, sir. I want to welcome everybody here to the Monday at 5 o'clock. It's 5:06. I am Adam Gomez, the chairman of Economic Development for the City of Springfield Subcommittee. We are joined by members of the administration and also members of the public. Today's economic development meeting on the agenda, we have a discussion on the proposed National Needle Building Local Historic District. Before we begin and start discussing this topic, I'm going to give everyone a chance for our viewers at home to introduce yourselves and the position and what you represent, so then we can commence working. We're gonna start with my colleagues, then the administration, then after that, if we have anybody, and then we'll go with the owner. If there's anybody from the, anybody else that wants to introduce themselves, they may. So I've already introduced myself. Also, members of this committee that just signed in, I apologize. President Justin Hirsch, welcome. And next, to my right, I would say my right, but I don't know if he's to my right or my left, Councilor Davila, you may introduce yourself.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. It's Councilor Davila. Just glad to see everybody. I'm just here to gather more information.
Yes,
gather more information on the subject.
Thank you. For the for everyone that's on the Zoom call, can you please mute your mic when you're not speaking, or I can mute you, or
hello, Cassandra.
We can mute ourselves. I'll mute all of you, no problem. So okay, members of the administration that are here representing the Economic Development Department, you may commence in introducing yourself.
Just Phil Dromey, Deputy Director of Planning, Office of Planning and Economic Development.
Okay. We have Mr. Walsh.
Vinny Walsh, Chairman of Springfield Historic Commission.
All right. And then we have Mr. Allen.
Hi, my name is Alvin Allen, Senior Planner in the Office of Planning and Economic Development, City of Springfield.
All right. We have members of the media that are here, Mr. Paul Tuthill. And also the owner, if you want to give us a brief overview of who you are and a little bit about yourself, outside of the project that we're talking about.
My name is Hansraj Gada. They call me Raj Gada. I own the Kittredge Building with my two other partners.
Thank you, sir, for joining us. All right. So I want to acknowledge that I did get some correspondence from the Department of Economic Development from Alvin Allen that yourself and the department had a meeting last week discussing this historic plan the project that we are looking to creating a historic district outside of the Kittredge Building. I'll let Mr. Alvin Allen begin and give us a little bit of synopsis of what exactly happened at that meeting and what was the result. So, Mr. Allen, you may take the floor, and then from there we will have more discussion if councilors have any questions, and from there try to close out as briefly as possible.
Yes, good evening, Councilor. So we met last Tuesday with the property owner, Mr. Gada. Folks from my office were present, my director, Philip Dromey, who's on the call today, Tim Sheehan, as well as Vincent Walsh, who is the chairman of the Springfield Historical Commission. We just met with Mr. Gada just to get a little bit of his side of, you know, the story in regards to how he felt about the proposed district and how it was going to affect him as a property owner. And I mean, I'll let him get into more detail as to, you know, what his opinions were. But, you know, from what I gathered is that he seemed rather, he wasn't overly opposed to the district. That's what we came away with from the city standpoint.
Okay, no problem. Thank you, Mr. Allen. Phil, is there anything that you would like to add before I go to the Historical Commission, and then I'll let Mr. Gada have the floor?
No, again, just to echo Alvin's, the meeting went very well. We appreciated Mr. Gatta being there. He indicated that he was aware that the, this was moving forward. He also was aware that the proposed district would only affect the four-story portion of the building and not the kind of the two-story building. He did indicate, again, I'll defer to Mr. Gatta, that there is a possible sale of the building and the potential owners were aware that this district could possibly move forward. Mr. Gatta also mentioned that he had some housing plans, but I think because of COVID-19, those had come to a kind of a abrupt halt. So I'll certainly defer to him on more of the details.
No problem. Thank you. Is there anything from the Historic Commission that you would like to add, Mr. Walsh?
No, there's nothing to add at this point.
All right. Thank you so much. Mr. Gatta, I want to thank you for joining us here today. I know that we have moved into first step pertaining this ordinance on creating a historic district around a property that you own. I know a couple years back that you were in front of the council for a zoning change a couple years ago when you had a proposed hotel housing situation that we were looking forward to, but now the city and also the historic district thought it was important to save that portion of the building that in the media we've looked at. It was you were looking to hypothetically demolition. So I'll let you have the floor and tell us a little bit of kind of a scope of where you're at when it comes to the building and on your side of things. With your meeting with the administration, how did it go? And you have the floor, Mr. Gatta.
Thank you. As far as I'm concerned, right now everything is standstill because my partners, they don't want to invest any money at this stage. So right now we'll keep the building as is. We are keep paying the taxes as usual. And till end of this year, nothing will be done at that building.
Mr. Gatta, do you have any objections of why we shouldn't create a historic district or we should or we shouldn't? Do you have any objection to Mr. Gatta?
Yes, because it will, if you create a historical district and if I need to fix that building, I'm going to spend a lot of money on that building, which is not going to be worth it for me.
All right. So you're under the impression that you believe that if we do not create a historic district, that it would cost you more money to develop the property?
Correct.
No. Do you believe that, sorry about that. Do you believe that because we're, I guess my question is for the administration. So Phil, how much time do we have left to the demolition delay? I don't know if that's a question for Alvin or for.
I think the deadline was September 5th. I'm not sure if that's such an emergency deadline or not an emergency, but a fast deadline, since it does not appear Mr. Gatta is in any kind of rush to demolish the building, but I do believe the demo delay, and I'll defer to Alvin, would expire on September 5th and allow him to move forward with demolition if he so chooses. And again, even if the district went forward, he could still demolish a good portion of the building, the two-story section of it, which is the majority of the building, and of course, the building would remain. And just to comment on the issues with regards to renovation, I do agree with Mr. Gatta. I mean, it wouldn't stop him from renovating the building, but it would require him, if the district is approved, he would have to come before the commission for work being done strictly for the exterior of the building. The interior of the building is not controlled by the Historical Commission, but for instance, if he wanted to replace windows or do some work to the exterior of the building, it would come under the purview of the Historical Commission for any work being done to the exterior.
All right, thank you, Phil. I just let the record show that we are joined by members of the City Council, Councilor Tim Allen. And please, if you guys have a chance, if you are not speaking, if you could please put your Zoom on mute, because there's a little bit of overcast and we want to make sure everybody's heard. Now I'm going to open it up for my colleagues on the City Council to ask any questions. I'm going to open it up. Please raise your hand in the participants menu so that I can know that if you have a question or not before I move a little bit forward, because I do want to hear a little bit of a little bit from the Historical Commission on why it's important to save and create an historic district there on at the Kitchens Building. So, my colleagues, if you have any questions, please raise your hand in the queue. I'll give you a couple moments to gather yourself and ask those questions. Seeing none, just a little bit of I hate to put you on the spot, my friend Vincent Walsh. Just if you can, for the members at home, to give a little bit of a brief history, if there is a little bit more to talk about this parcel that we want to create a historic district.
Well, let me just start by part of what the purview is of the Historic Commission, especially when it comes to a demo delay. Anything over the 100 years comes before us, and our determination is, does it have historic value? And as you know, we reviewed that and we found it did, and we also elected to send it out to for further, you know, expansion of the historic details. And then a motion was made to make it a historical district, which passed the commission. So we try to protect any building that has historical significance, historical detail. We just don't want them to automatically be torn down. And it doesn't mean everyone should or shouldn't be, but we wanted to make sure all the historical perspective was on the table before any decisions were made. And that's why we sent it ahead. And of course, it ends up at the City Council level. We believe it's a historical building and it has historical significance.
Thank you so much. Any of my colleagues, again, have any questions specific to any questions when it comes to for Mr. Gatta or for the administration? Okay, we have a question from my colleague, Tracy Whitfield. Tracy, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I don't know a lot about this building, so what is the historic significance of it?
Well, it was a national needle company founded in 1873, and that's where the significance starts. I'll just read you a little bit of the history if you don't mind. In 1879, produced 6 million needles per year, both for machine and hand sewing. Largest needle maker in the world at one time. But that's not just the history of the significance, but the detail in the construction of the building. You know, it's part of what we try to do is preserve the, it's because we only have purview over the exterior. So the only changes that someone ever has to bring before us are to change the way something looks. And in fact, if they're going to replace it or repair it exactly the way it is, it's really a non-issue with us. So I'm not sure if that helps, Tracy, but go ahead.
Yeah, understandable. Thank you.
Okay.
Councilor Whitfield, does that end your question?
Yes.
No problem. Thank you for your questions. All right. Mr. Allen, is it in the best interest, do you believe, of the administration? Because I was contacted by you and your office on supporting this effort, which we have worked on plenty of these historic districts that were just buildings that we've been doing in the past, let's say, 2 or 3 years, instead of whole neighborhoods. Respectfully, you know, Willie's Overlay, if I'm right. And then also we did the house on Byer Street. And then we did a building on Bridge Street, if I'm correct. And now this is another building that has come before us. And I know before we've tried to, the last two, this had came up on, you know, why are we just singling out certain buildings? Essentially, I have been around the building. The building has a very unique look to it. And I know that it's not the entire block that is salvageable to this historic district. And it's only just that corner parcel that's closest to, I forget the street. I think it's on Boylston, corner of Boylston and another street. But in your opinion, just a little bit more before, I don't know if there's a motion that we can take. I know that maybe this is going to be another conversation on the floor when it comes up for second and third step. But in your personal opinion, does the city want to make sure that we save this parcel, or this, or save or create this historic district per se? Sorry.
From the city standpoint, you're asking me if.
Yes, sir. From the city standpoint.
I mean, again, this is a petition by the Springfield Historical Commission. So, we did have the meeting with the property owner last Tuesday, because, again, we wanted to make sure that we were also protecting his interests. And we are also very interested in the economic development of that particular area. But I'm not sure that, you know, we're going to take one side over the other.
Understand.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, just to echo on that, again, I think that the district originally, I think, started through the Springfield Preservation Trust. Obviously, as the city, we certainly want to protect all our historic assets while still making sure we kind of, look at the other side as well as far as economic development and reuse. I mean, again, this is kind of a unique parcel with the building only being kind of like a quarter of the parcel. So while I understand the owner's side of it, it is a historic asterisk. We do try and save what we can, but we understand that that has to be taken into consideration, that we certainly don't want this to become a building that kind of remains vacant due to the fact that it's a historic property that doesn't serve anybody's purposes. And we do believe that buildings can be reused. There are avenues that can be used through the historic tax credits, both state and federal. So I believe while it does probably add some additional costs to renovation, I do think there's avenues out there that allow a developer to utilize them. And an example of that is the Elm Street building that's in the process that you guys just recently approved. They're using both state and federal tax credits to be able to redevelop that building. So there are avenues out there, but it's got to be weighed on both sides.
You answered my next question, and just how interesting that this building, being made a historic district, could assist maybe Mr. Gada and using it as a vehicle to tap into those resources of historic tax credits. I think that, from what I read in the last, report that I seen in the media, was that Mr. Gada, this question is for you. It's, you said that this building has a strong skeleton, strong bones. It's a sturdy building. And it's ready for an investor like yourself or your partners to do something interesting there. And it being created into a historic district, it does give you an avenue to be able to tap into the historic tax credits that could be available from year to year. Did you know that once it's created a historic district, that avenue could be something that you could utilize to help develop it, you and your partners?
No, I had no knowledge of that, but good to know that.
Yeah, I wanted to talk to you a little bit about that, because sometimes some of these buildings, and I know that you came before us with a vision, tower, you know, something very high that would go over the
highway.
The highway. Half of it was going to be a highway when my I first became part of the council. And a lot of my colleagues, when we create or where we voted in favor of the zone change is because we were really looking forward for those spinoffs and that kind of development, in, specifically in Ward 1 when it came to the Kittredge building. And I know with the pandemic, it has created some troublesome avenues specific to a lot of things that's going on with the economy. But I really, you know, I think you not having knowledge of the fact that once it's a historic district, maybe it would create those avenues where you can talk to other partners or when, like you said that there was a developer that was looking to buying your property, you said? I read that.
There is a developer, but it's still, we are in a negotiation stage, you know. They don't mind having a historical property.
All right, so the potential buyer is not an objection if it has historic, being a historic district, which would lead to me to believe that they understand that the probability of them entertaining the fact of getting historical tax credits is what they're probably going to lead you to be able to sell this property. I think that, you know, and this is just my opinion. I'm not telling you what to do or what not to do. Right. I believe that if we were to save your property and create a historic district, it would make it more of an valuable asset. But then moving forward for development, for other developers and yourself to be able to tap into those resources of historic tax credits. And that's just my opinion. And since you didn't know any of that information, I think I would really urge you to reach out to administration to kind of help you through that process, to help you understand it a little bit better, what's the direction you need to go through the state to learn about that avenue of resources.
I appreciate that. Yeah, I'd definitely love to explore more possibility, what I can get from the state and federal government.
All right. My colleagues on the city council, it seems that we kind of have, I don't necessarily have a quorum. I do have President Justin Hurst here with me. On the floor, I was in favor of creating a historic district when it came to this specific parcel, this building. I know that if the only other member of this committee is Councilor Hurst. If Councilor Hurst, if you have anything else to add, I think at the moment, you know, I'm not going to beat a dead horse. I think we've heard from everyone. And at the moment, we are trying to alleviate and figure out where we're going to be going next. But I know that we're going to be hearing this in second and third step. And there's a lot of the council that's not here. And I think that some of that conversation, when I do my report, specifically on this matter, we could have a debate on the floor on what is our next move. And without us, you know, without objection, not really taking a vote today, just hearing the update on the meeting that happened with economic development and the property owner.
That makes that makes perfect sense to me, Mr. Chair.
All right, fantastic. So at the moment, I want to be on the record that I am supporting a historic district at this time, but we cannot take a vote and I will not entertain a vote because I know that there's still, I guess, more conversation because the property owner did not even realize that maybe this historic district is an asset and is a help for him to probably even cross the goalpost when it comes to the dream and the vision that he had some odd 3 years ago when I was first in the council and came for this zone change. I think that, you know, with a little bit more investigating on his part, but also moving forward, I know the double delay is ahead of us. I just want to simply urge my colleagues to reach out to myself and to other members that were here before we hear this in the next upcoming weeks. But for the most part, I think that's all that we have right now. If there's any last thoughts from the administration or the historical commission, I will entertain this now before I close out the meeting. Seeing none, I want to thank everybody for taking the time to come, for joining us here on Focus Springfield. I want to thank Focus Springfield, our members from the media. Mr. Gada, thank you so much for being here. I look forward to reaching out to you and having a more in-depth conversation with you. I'm happy that you are here. A lot of people were wondering, you know, if you were around, but you are here. I hope you and the family are doing well. And everybody from the administration and my colleagues, thank you. God bless. Have a great night. And we will be seeing each other soon.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gomez.